Sampling is a fundamental part of the social sciences. It is nearly impossible to observe every case or person in a population. Instead, we take a sample and record observations of a smaller number of cases. In the field of survey research, we distinguish between two types of sampling: probability sampling and non-probability sampling. Non-probability sampling doesn't use random selection. It might instead rely on subjects that are readily available. For example, a large introductory political science class at a university. The students in that class are not there by chance. It's not a random selection of students, and thus not a representative sample of students at that university. Nor would it even be a representative sample of students majoring in political science. Probability sampling, on the other hand, uses some type of random selection. When you want precise, accurate estimates of a large population, then a probability sample is what is needed. Want to know who's going to win an upcoming election? Then probability sampling is likely to be the most accurate method to find out the answer. Although most polling organizations have been using some type of probability sampling since 1948, there are still many people that have a hard time believing that a sample of less than 2,000 adults could accurately tell us anything about all the 240 million adults living in the United States. For example, in the 2012 presidential election, many pollsters came within a couple of percentage points of estimating the votes of over 130 million voters. Throughout the election, many pundits and critics said the polls must be wrong. The polls were biased. But in the end, most of the polls were within a couple of percentage points from the actual election results. Besides a proven track record, probability sampling has several advantages. First, sampling a population saves an enormous amount of time and money compared to trying to contact everyone in a population. The 2010 U.S. Census, which attempted to contact every household, cost approximately $13 billion and needed to hire 635,000 temporary workers. Second, the use of random selection methods helps avoid biases in selecting people to study. Research has shown humans are not very good at being random. If you and I went outside to survey people about a topic, any topic, we're likely to go up to people who look friendly, and we're likely to avoid people who look like they might be in a bad mood. And we're likely to go up to people that look and dress like us. These conscious or subconscious biases would produce a biased, inaccurate sample. Random selection helps us avoid these biases and produces a sample that is generally very representative of the true population. And third, probability sampling allows us to calculate confidence intervals and margins of error, which tells us how confident we are about our estimates. I'm sure you've seen some survey report or chart where some percentage is given and then a margin of error is also provided. That margin of error is taking into account the fact that the percentage is based on a sample and that we don't have information about the entire population. And that margin of error is only meaningful when you're dealing with probability samples. I think a healthy amount of skepticism about polling and surveys is a good thing. Skepticism is an important element of the scientific method. Skepticism causes us to ask questions. And one of the first questions you should ask about a poll is, how was the sample selected? If the sample was selected through probability sampling, then there's a good chance the results are accurate and generalizable to a larger population.